Let's please stand together as we start our morning in worship.
Yeah, we got you nice and warmed up. Stand up on your feet if you can.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love.
Child of God,
yes, I am.
Realize speak what is true. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord.
Speak what is true.
Speak what is true.
I am found. I am yours. I am.
Please be seated. Good morning. Two of our announcements. The congregational meeting to discuss the air conditioning will be next Sunday, right after the service. We have our day of prayer and fasting that will begin on Monday, tomorrow at dinner time. Have dinner, and the goal is to fast until the dinner on Tuesday. Not everyone is required to be fasting. This is something we're not even keeping track of who is doing that. But we are also doing 24 hours of prayer. And we really would like everyone to be involved in that. There'll be a table out in the parlor. Jane and Holly will be out in the parlor to take and fill in any of the time slots. There's half hour slots that you can choose. And by the way, if you see with despair that there's only, 3 a.m. And you happen to think sleeping happens at 3 a.m. and you haven't signed up yet, you can put your name next to any block that works for you. Having more than one person praying during that half hour period is okay with us. It's okay with God. We can do that. So please, if you haven't signed up, sign up. We have our fall festival coming up on September 28th at noontime, and we're asking you to be on board and how you might be able to help. Please be inviting people. This is an outreach event, and there is a need for pies to be made. So talk to Karen or Janet about making pies if you like pies. You can also talk to me about making pies. What's that? Many pies. If you can't catch either of them, I will always take, note of who's making pies, so you can check in with me. What's that? Bob says chocolate cream is his favorite. Okay. My only favorite is one that has sugar. Join us for lunch while we're talking about fasting, prayer, and food. Join us for lunch every Sunday right down the hallway. Please join us. We want to continue praying for Father Joe at St. Joseph's for the kidney transplant that he is waiting to have. He has a donor. He's just waiting for the right time for health of both of them to be able to have that done. So we want to continue lifting them up. We have information cards if you are new here. Then they look like this. You can fill out your contact information and put it in the offering plate. And you can also put prayer requests. This is for anybody to put a prayer request on and put it in the offering plate as well. We're about to enter into a time of prayer, but we're asking that we pray for things that are urgent, need to be shared with the body, and for the other requests to either be filled out on a prayer card or sent in an email to our prayer email address, prayer@firstchurchnb.org. We are in the habit now of adding a scripture verse each month where we're all praying the same verse and asking God to implement that verse in our lives and in our community. This is the verse that we're looking at this month from Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. There are good things that God has prepared in advance for us to do. It's not our job to invent God's will. It's our job to detect it. And so we are praying that prayer. May we detect your will in our lives, the good things that you've prepared in advance for us to do. So we'll be adding that in our prayer. And we always put our extended community so that we can be praying and thinking of them as well. Other requests that I have, the Wassons, Scott Wasson's mom passed away on Friday. We've been praying for that, for him and for his mom, Alice. And we just want to continue to pray for the family as they gather. Some people are traveling distance to get here. And so we want to be praying for the Wassons. And they talked with me. They're very appreciative of all of the prayers that this church has been pouring out on their behalf. Other requests that we should be aware of? Yeah?
My friend Lori Jacobson has stage 4 cancer.
Thanks. Yeah.
Donna was finally able to get her treatment, only that she had an allergic reaction to it, so she's on her program.
Thanks. Yeah.
Steve, one of my good friends, he had a heart attack or a stroke the other day, and they won't let me know.
Yeah, Mona. I'm sorry, Mona. I am not hearing you.
My neighbor, Elizabeth Smith, that has a family hot last year, almost passed away. She's been home, but this morning, early this morning, the ambulance came to get her out to her hospital. I don't know the results yet. I get home.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, Celia.
Pray for our sister Patty King, and she leaves today. I just spent the winter in Florida.
Okay. Yes, definitely. Yeah. Julia? Father, we once again, as an act of worship, come before you. We lift up to you Scott and Beth and their family as they grieve the loss of Scott's mom. We ask that your comfort, your peace, would rest upon them. We continue, Lord, to pray for Lori Jacobson with her cancer and for Donna as well, and we pray over this allergic reaction that she has had. Lord, we pray for Steve, who has had a heart attack, stroke, or we don't know, but we are confident that you do. And so whatever needs he has, we pray over that. And Lord, we pray for Elizabeth Smith, and taken to the hospital by ambulance this morning. We lift up her to you, the doctors that are treating her. Lord, we lift up Pat to you. We love her, and she has served so many in love here. And so, Lord, we just pray that her time right now in Florida would be relaxing and comforting, and Lord, that she would do well there. And if it's your will to bring her back here, Lord, we pray over that as well. And Lord, we praise you for Sarah and the girls making it to Canada. We praise you for the answer to prayer with this cult that is in the airport. And we pray for traveling as they prepare to all go back to the Philippines later this week. Lord, we lift up Linda Jones to you and Anna Marie, that they would feel better quickly and that there would be no complications from anything that they're experiencing. Lord, we praise you that the Adamses are here together with us, and we thank you for all of us that are here worshiping today. We are, Lord, your workmanship. We were created in you, in Christ, to do good works. We ask that you would give us insight to detect what those good works are, that we might be all about the things that you've prepared already beforehand for us to do. And as we move forward into the word this morning, may your Holy Spirit be present, challenging us, changing us, transforming us, speaking to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Continuing on, and we're getting there. We're getting there. We're about to hit a milestone. We've been looking at the Gospel of Luke, the pre-formal history, the Galilean ministry, and the journey to Jerusalem will be completed. We'll be in Jerusalem after next week. So Jesus is very close to Jerusalem. He's now in Jericho, about 17 miles from Jerusalem. And today, last week rather, we looked at the rich ruler and Jesus talking about Jerusalem and all that will happen, his crucifixion, his resurrection, all of that he's talking about as he is completing this journey, setting his face towards Jerusalem. Today, we look at the blind beggar. This is the title that is given. It's called a pericope, and the blind beggar and the story of Zacchaeus. The story of Zacchaeus, I understand, has been around, you know, for so many years that there are hieroglyphics and catacombs in Rome with hand motions singing the song that is today still sung in Sunday school. Maybe not. This is the text that we're looking at today. This is the story of the blind beggar and Zacchaeus. Pretty straightforward. That's what we're looking at today. So let's just look at this story, the blind beggar. Jericho, as I had just said, is 17 miles outside of Jerusalem. It's north of the Dead Sea, and it happens to be 850-ish feet below sea level. It's one of the lowest places on earth. And so this is where our storyline is taking place. And here's what the text says. As Jesus drew near to Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. A blind man in Jesus' day was not something that was easily managed. We think today that there's books that are written in Braille, there's sounds at intersections, there's tools and there's dogs and there are the different electronics and stuff that are available now for someone to have a sense of where they are. And someone blind in Jesus' day had no opportunity to an education, had no opportunity to truly work and earn an income. And so this blind beggar sits at the side of the road begging. He's sitting there, as he always does. But he notices the frequency and the volume of foot traffic, the sounds of what's going on beginning to increase. Jesus has a large following as he's coming into Jerusalem. There's a large following and there are people around him. And hearing a crowd going by, he inquired what this meant. Why the noise? Why all of the crowd? The Facebook posts are probably going crazy in Jericho. You know, why the traffic tie up at the center of town and people responding? You know, Jesus is there. And so they told him, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. And I just wonder what it might have looked like in his mind, in the darkness of his blindness. Hearing that Jesus of Nazareth is passing by, and an opportunity for more than just a donation, for somebody to put a coin in a cup, something much more than that. Jesus is passing by, and I wonder if there isn't just in the darkness of his blindness, just the slightest light of hope that his life could be different, that things could be transformed and changed. He had heard of Jesus healing someone else who was blind. He had heard of Jesus raising someone from the dead. He had heard of all of the different miracles. And in his darkness, did he see a ray of hope that was the smallest of light waiting to be pierced through his eyelids? And so he begins to cry out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Imagine the depth of the crowd, the commotion that's going on. For someone to be heard, the volume of their voice, he is shouting, he is screaming, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. This is one of the things that I do when I go to the monastery to pray. I just sit. I don't shout it, but I sit, and in my mind I shout it, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And I keep repeating it and over and repeating it. And so here he is crying out, Jesus, Son of David. Jesus is entering into Jerusalem, the city of David. And here he proclaims, the blind man proclaims what the apostles last week couldn't see and couldn't get. The one without sight has more sight. And calls out to Jesus, not just as Jesus of Nazareth, but Jesus, Son of David. A proclamation of a fulfillment of a messianic dream that the Messiah was coming and in fact had come. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Can you hear him yelling it loud enough to pierce through the crowd? The amount of courage that would take to just boldly scream out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And he cried out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me. And those who were in front, those who were in the crowd in front, crowding around, edging him out, are trying to prevent him. They're trying to keep him silent. They're rebuking him and telling him, shut up. You don't matter. He doesn't want to hear from you. That doesn't stop him. That doesn't stop him. In fact, he gets louder and louder and louder. And those who were in front rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David, have mercy on me. This is a fulfillment of the parable we just saw of the persistent widow who will not stop, who will not cease, who will continue. Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David, have mercy on me. He's not going to stop until he has an audience with the Son of David. And Jesus stopped and commanded him to be brought. And when he came near, he asked him a question. They bring the children to Jesus, just in the last chapter. They bring the children to Jesus, and there's a group of people saying, send them away. In fact, the disciples are in the mix. Send them away. They're insignificant. They don't matter. And here this blind man is being silenced and told, you don't matter. Send them away. Be quiet. And Jesus stops in the middle of a large crowd, looks at him, and he can't see that Jesus is looking at him. But I wonder if that small pinpoint of a light is growing and growing inside of his mind to this beautiful place of recognition that he has the attention of Jesus, Son of David. Imagine the stopping and the whole crowd silenced. What is he doing? Why is he paying attention to the insignificant and the unimportant and the don't matters? And he comes near and he asks a simple question. What do you want me to do for you? Man, I would love to be asked that question. And yet, every time we approach him in prayer, he's asking that question. What would you ask for? What should he ask for? Should he ask for wisdom like Solomon? You know, when Solomon was asked, what would you like? Solomon asked for wisdom. Would he ask for wisdom? Should he have asked for wisdom? Was he out of line to ask for his sight? The indication is that he's asking for his sight again, that somehow he has lost it and he's asking to receive his sight again. Lord, let me recover my sight. That's his priority. He can't function in society as a blind man. Let me recover my sight. Recover your sight. Your faith has made you well. And immediately, he recovered his sight and followed him, glorifying God. The power that Jesus has with words, because he's the incarnate word, he spoke everything in existence into existence. And now he just merely says, see. The Greek here is a see again or see. And he follows him. That tells us something. I don't know. I'd want to go home. See what my house looks like if he had one. I'd want to see somebody. I'd want to go see somebody I haven't seen for a while to see how much they've aged. I'd want to see some scenery. I'd want to see the Grand Canyon. I'd want to see something big. I'd want to take it all in. And all he wants to do with his sight is follow him. And that should be our response when we receive sight, when we are blind and then are able to see spiritually where we stand and our identity in Christ. Our response should be to follow and to praise him, glorify him. And when that happens, all of the people, when they saw it, gave praise to God. The whole crowd. Imagine the first thing that he sees is the face of Christ. Never to be blind again. The one on the side of the road begging is now the one on the road following. Wow. These are paired together. The story of Zacchaeus takes place in Jericho. The story of the blind beggar as they're entering into Jericho, and now they are in the city of Jericho. And now we find this story, the story of Zacchaeus. This is a bookend to the story of the rich ruler. Here's the rich ruler walks away sad because he had so many possessions. And in this story, the rich and wealthy and powerful Zacchaeus is transformed. The book ends between the two. And so the text reads, he entered Jericho and was passing through. He wasn't intending to stay. He was passing through. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. A chief tax collector in the Judea area would not have come under the king as in Galilee, but would come directly under Rome, giving him more power, more authority. Zacchaeus is the chief tax collector. He's in charge of all of the tax collectors. Today is September 15th. Anybody know what that is? What's that, Bob?
The Ides of September.
The Ides of September, yeah. Anybody else? September 15th. We're halfway to tax day? Bill?
Is it like a start of national Hispanic History Month?
It could be. September 15th. Last day to file an extension. If you are self-employed, and I'm categorized as self-employed, a quarterly tax payment is due today. Because of it falling on a Sunday, I get to keep my money one more day. And I will not go online and submit that payment until it's just about out. Thousands of dollars sent to the IRS. I wonder how I would feel if it wasn't so benign, if it wasn't like you just log in. That's how I do it now. I just log into the MassDOR website, I log into the IRS website, and I just type in a number that I don't like, and I hit enter. It's benign. But what if someone on these dates, on these quarterly dates, just showed up at your door and pounded on the door and said, "Where's the money?"
I never and, shotgun
ready. and not just where's the money, but not just where's the money, but and I want more. I want more. I want more of a cut. That's what tax collectors did. They had a minimum they had to bring in, and anything over the top of that that they could extract, they did. So just how do you think the public felt about the chief tax collector? To his face, oh, he's a great guy. Behind his back, oh, he is us. Yeah, I'm in the pulpit. That's what's going on here. He is the chief tax collector. And he was seeking to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not. Because he was vertically challenged. small in stature. I saw a spoof. There's a website or whatever, the Babylon Bee, that does these satire things, and one of them said that The Chosen has casted Danny DeVito to be Zacchaeus. And I thought, that's who I would go for. So Zacchaeus is short. And what we learn in the song is that he was a wee man, and that he climbed the tree to see, right? You know, I didn't grow up in a church that taught that song, but I've seen it. And he was seeking to see Jesus, but on account of the crowd, he could not because he was small in stature. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was about to pass that way. Here's a picture of a sycamore tree in Jericho. It's a big tree. It's not something small. And so he runs ahead and he climbs this tree. But the problem is, as I look at this text, I'm perplexed. The big question mark, the big question mark just comes into my head. Yeah, he was short. Yeah, the crowd was above him. But do you think he had a problem accessing Jesus? The rich ruler that we just looked at. Did the rich ruler have a problem? The children had a problem. They were being rejected. The blind man had a problem. They were being rejected. The rich ruler that we just looked at, right in to see Jesus. What do you think about the chief tax collector? Do you think anyone is going to say, you? No, you can't get in. You know, how many people are rebuking him? I think we will open an audit against you. You can go. Take my place. Here's a man who is extremely wealthy. Does he have access to Jesus if he wants to get through the crowd and stand before Jesus? He does. Here's a man who is extremely powerful. Does he have access to he could have just said, put a chair 30 yards down the road and make him stop where my seat is. Here's a person who has connections everywhere, and everyone wants to perform a favor for him so that perhaps they can call on him themselves. Here's a man who has protection. The chief tax collector, the chief tax collector has armed people around him. He doesn't just walk through Jericho unattended any more than the Secret Service does not attend, you know, the president. This is someone who's politically connected, who's extremely important, and extremely hated. He has guards all around him. Does he have access to just approaching Jesus? He does. He's the one who has the best seats in the synagogue. He's the one who walks in and everybody stands and moves and shuffles around. He's the one Jesus has been talking about saying, don't take the best seats. He can demand the seats. But he doesn't. Instead, he looks at a trajectory of where Jesus is going to be and he climbs a tree. And I just want to tell you that adult men, even short adult men, don't climb trees. Any more than the prodigal son's father, you know, it was an embarrassment for him to gird up his loins and run to his son. The noble, the character, all of that would not allow and permit it. The chief tax collector isn't going to climb a tree. That, if anything, people are looking going, what the, do you see that? Zacchaeus is climbing a tree? This is not the norm. The chief tax collector climbing a tree. The chief tax collector does what he chooses, goes where he wants.
but perhaps he knows that all of his wealth, power, connections, and stature means nothing to Jesus. It doesn't impress him at all. He's not looking for connections. He's not looking for a future favor. He's about the kingdom business. We looked at this back in chapter 18. We just started into chapter 19. Just back in chapter 18, the parable of the persistent widow, and we talked about the blind person, the blind beggar, exemplified that. But then the next is the parable that Jesus told about the Pharisee and the tax collector. I want you to ask the question, could it be that Zacchaeus's mindset, that Zacchaeus's frame of mind is in line, perhaps, with the tax collector in this prayer? Perhaps Jesus has even said this parable in multiple times. Perhaps Zacchaeus has even heard this. And so just looking at that section of Scripture, and again, this is just a chapter ago that we worked through this. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. The rich young ruler was trusting in himself, thinking he was righteous. So some that thinking that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you I'm not like the other men. Extortioners, that's what tax collectors did. Unjust, adulterers, and even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes all that I get. But the tax collector, look at the mindset, the attitude of the tax collector in this parable. The tax collector standing far off, not trying to get right in front of things, but at a distance, standing far off, would not even lift his eyes towards heaven, but beat his breast saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. I think Zacchaeus is seeking an audience with Jesus, but doesn't believe he deserves that audience. He climbs the tree to just see him, because perhaps seeing him would be enough. He was not expecting what happens next. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and he said to him, the same Greek word, he looked up, same Greek word as telling the blind man to see. He's saying, see. He's seeing him. And so he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus. He knows his name. He knows his name. He knows the name of the insignificant. He knows the name of the rich and the powerful. He knows their name. He knows my name. He knows your name. Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. What? That's like saying, come on down, I'm going to stay at your house to the mafia boss. I'll stay with you. So he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. Received him. Same Greek word as, unless you receive me like the children here in front of me, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Received him. He, Zacchaeus, received him joyfully, hospitably, The idea here of received is receive with all of the hospitality that can be given. And when they saw it, they all grumbled. The crowd, they all grumbled. He's gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. It's one thing when he's with other sinners, but I mean, the chief of them all, the kingpin of them all, he's going to go to his house. And people are upset. People don't get it. They don't understand why would someone who is holy and righteous want anything to do with someone who's not. And Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, "Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I've defrauded," I'm going to go back to that, "and if I've defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold." What is really interesting here is that they are at the house. In the same way that Matthew threw a banquet when he was called, Zacchaeus is throwing a banquet when he has been called. There's a crowd around that are judgmental and saying, "Why is he doing that? He shouldn't be doing that. That's wrong. That's not right." And here Zacchaeus is there in his house, and he stands up and he says to Jesus, "Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor." This is in the present tense. He isn't saying, "I will." Every indication is that either this has been his common practice, he's been doing this all along, right along, before Jesus entered into the scene, giving half of his stuff and forgiving four times if he's extorted. The Greek could suggest that, except why are the people calling him a sinner? And why is he climbing up? It doesn't make sense for that. The alternative, and what I seem to believe is being implied here with this present tense, is that he is at the banquet and he's giving stuff away right then, right there. And if there's somebody in front of him that he's extorted, he's paying them back right then, right there, and will continue to do that right there. He's been changed. Imagine the crowd that's grumbling, saying, "What is he even doing with them?" And then Zacchaeus saying, "I'm sorry. I have extorted money from you. Here is four times what the record shows." Imagine the knock on the door. You know, the IRS knocks on my door for the quarterly payment, and I hate that guy. But imagine he knocks on the door and he just says, "Seems to me you've paid more than you should. Here's four times back. I think I would like that, IRS agent. I welcome that." Imagine the transformative power of people seeing how Zacchaeus has been transformed, not only in his deeds, in his words rather, but in his deeds, in his actions. "I give to the poor, and if I've defrauded anyone else, I restore it." Present tense. And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, since he also is a son of Abraham." Today, salvation has come to this house. Today's the day for salvation for any of us not having understood or experienced that. The intersecting point of Jesus passing by is here, is now. For the Son of Man, I'm sorry, I want to go back. Today's salvation has come to this house. The impossible. Jesus said it is impossible for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. The rich ruler walks away. But now, the impossible is possible. And as Jesus is saying, "Today, salvation has come to this house," I can just hear perhaps one of the apostles saying, "With man, this is impossible, But with God, all things are possible. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. That is everything. The Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. All the way back in chapter 4. All the way back in chapter 4, we find, and the people sought him and came to him. They would have kept him from leaving them, but he said to them, I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns as well, for I was sent for this purpose. In turn, Jesus trains his disciples and sends them for the very same purpose. 2,000 years later, he is sending us for the very same purpose. And I just want to quickly draw some of the beautiful connections to all of this and how Scripture is woven together, connections to parables and stories. The calling of Matthew, we can see that here. He calls Zacchaeus, the tax collector. There's a huge banquet. Salvation has come to his house. The mustard seed, the small amount of faith of the blind man calling out, Jesus, Son of David. The lost sheep, the blind man is a lost sheep. Zacchaeus is a lost sheep. The wedding feast is being portrayed here in this banquet that is being thrown by Zacchaeus. And the Good Samaritan, it's the same road that Jesus talks about the Good Samaritan. And Jesus is the one who stops and helps the outcast. And we see that connection. We see the rich fool who thinks he can just do whatever he wants with his money and his life being demanded tomorrow is being portrayed here. The prodigal son, the same embarrassing move of the father running across the field to his son with his legs exposed. Zacchaeus climbs a tree to get a glimpse of Jesus. The rich man and Lazarus is being portrayed and contrasted between the beggar and Zacchaeus. The persistent widow is being looked at by the persistence of the blind beggar calling out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. The tax collector and the Pharisee parable are living out right here in front of us. The rich ruler walks away sad because he had so many possessions. And here the rich ruler stays. Gives away half of all he owns, pays back restitution for all that he has wronged. The children being brought to Jesus, receiving him, Zacchaeus receiving Christ. Today salvation has come to your house. So I just ask the question, a few questions. What causes you to be in despair and to lose hope? Could you see that small dot in the darkness and cry out persistently, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me? Are you near the place where Jesus would walk? I mean, Jesus will find you. I'm not saying that he can't find you wherever you are, but wouldn't it make sense to think about where Jesus would be and to show up so that when he passes by, you're there? That's what our Sunday morning service is, a place where God's presence is. Jesus is passing by. What's your response? Passing by. Jesus is passing by. His voice is thunderous like a jet. I think it's circle pattern now. Wow. Jesus is passing by. What's your response? What are your blind spots? What are your blind spots that become obstacles that need to be removed? What do you want me to do for you? What would your answer be if asked that question? How can you act in ways that intersect with Jesus' trajectory? We need to be aware of what God is doing around us and what that means and where it's going. And we need to set a course to intercept right there. with him. The name Zacchaeus means clean, innocent. Zacchaeus was anything but clean and innocent. But with those words, today salvation has come to this house. Zacchaeus' name becomes a testimony to who he is. Clean, innocent, like a babe. I'm on a roll. The faith of a child. We're all vertically challenged. We're all vertically challenged. You cannot obtain salvation through the things that you do. You can't climb a tree high enough. We are all vertically challenged, and we have to have someone who can take away the barriers that challenge us. There's nothing more important than to hear those words, today salvation has come to this house. Where are you in your own walk? And if you have questions on that, talk to me. Talk to one of us. What a great story. The blind beggar and Zacchaeus. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word, for giving us the ability to walk through story and feel and touch and taste and smell the beauty of the gospel. May we be like the blind beggar, persistent and never giving up, recognizing you as the Messiah, the Son of David. And may we be like Zacchaeus, changed and transformed in word and in deed. Help us. We are vertically challenged, and we need you. We pray this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line, with all the other not quite, all the never get it right. But it turns out we're the ones you were looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Moses had stage fright. Peter brought a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders, nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. The moral of the story is, everybody's got a purpose. But when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. Living for the world, world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Cause I'm just an nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing.
Gave me a song to sing.
Never for the world to see.
Nobody but Jesus.
Never for the world to see.
Nobody but Jesus.
Never for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus. You believe that? Say amen.
Amen. Our closing hymn, 347. Please stand if you're able. And can it be? Just struck by the third verse. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray. I woke.
awoke, the dungeons flamed with light. My chains fell off. My heart was free. I rose, went forth, and followed thee. That's like the blind beggar's story. A ray of quickening light. His chains fell off. His heart was free. He rose and followed thee. Our benediction comes from Ephesians 2:10. And we'll read that together, and then I'll close us in prayer. Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Lord, we want to know these good works that you have prepared in advance. We want to set our trajectory to arrive where you are, and we want to follow you. We are your workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, your Son. Help us to follow you and to live out this life of faith, working on these things that you've prepared in advance for us to do. In Jesus' name, we give thanks and praise. Amen.